Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 8th August 2018. The topics we are going to cover today includes these 7. Apart from these 7, the NRC article was also repeated. The NRC issue has been analyzed in detail for past few days and you can go back to check the issue. The first issue we are going to see today is with respect to the skill development. Rebooting the system for skills upgrade. We all know that India is a highly populated country. We also have very rich demographic dividend, but the utilization of demographic dividend requires skill development programs. With respect to the skill development, the government has initiated several welfare schemes to educate the youth and empower them economically. Recently, a report was submitted by Standing Committee on Labour titling Industrial Training Institute and Skill Development Initiative Scheme. This is an initiative under Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship. This report provided empirical analysis of various skill development program and the implementation and the limitation detail in a detailed manner. Seeing the skill development programs historically, from 1950s to 2007, there were only about 1,896 training institutes in our country, which included both public as well as private institutes. Whereas after 2007 till 2017, this 10 years saw a rapid growth of industrial training institutes. For example, there was an increase of about 9,000 additional ITIs in private sector alone. We have to analyze why this growth, especially the growth in the private ITIs. Because of the private sector engagement in the ITIs, the quality of the skill training provided and the efficiency with which the skill training has been provided has taken a toll. The private providers do not always follow the norms and the standards which are to be followed according to the government rules. In addition to this, there is no single regulator to regulate the skill development sector in our country. This has affected the quality of affiliation, assessment and also the certification given to the youths. The private sector engagement with respect to the skill development sector has been done by standalone private training providers and not the employers. This mismatch has led to the trained youths not meeting the employers' market requirements. There is also increasing ownership tussle between the ITIs owned by the central and the state governments, which has led to confusion and chaos. There is also the problem of inter-body conflict with the organizations involved in the skill development programs. For example, the government bought in Quality Council of India, which is a private body, to ensure the regulation of norms with respect to the skill development programs. However, the norms are actually created by National Council of Vocational Training, which is a government body. This two mismatches led to ownership issues. For example, the question papers are separately prepared by NCVT, but the administration and the evaluation are done by State Council for VTs. Such problems affected the quality of skill imparted to the young people. Also, the youths who are enrolled under the ITIs do not have any Aadhaar checks or minimum attendance requirements or batch size limitations, which are very essential to maintain the quality of skill offered to them. All these issues has led to the private sector operators accumulating more profit instead of concentrating on the quality of skills required to harness the demographic dividend. The National Survey by Research Institute, which was part of Planning Commission, constituted the survey in the year 2011. According to it, the private ITI providers had very few classrooms, conducted very few workshops for practice of the skills gained, and teachers were very poorly educated and paid when compared to the government ITIs. All these problems calls for serious reforms required in the skill development sector in our country. In order to bring in changes, Shraddha Prasad Committee has suggested some of recommendations which can be brought in to develop the skill development sector in our country. According to the committee, a new national board for skill development must be constituted, and this board will regulate the syllabus and the rules which are to be followed to impart skills throughout the country. In order to increase the efficiency and also to bring in competition among different ITIs, ranking methodology can be followed. For example, the NAAC rank for the tertiary education in our country, which has been done for the past 2 years, is a good example to ITIs also. There is also a need to bring in a unified national vocational system in order to eliminate the differences in the vocational education system between different states. The committee has also recommended unique law in order to regulate the skill development program in our country. That is, a National Vocational Act has to be brought in as per the recommendation of 12th Five-Year Plan in order to regulate this vocational education sector. The skill development sector also requires some of internal changes. For example, the staffs need to be properly educated, the number of staffs with respect to number of students, the ratio must be maintained, etc. With the improvement in technology in almost all the domains in our country, the skill development sector also needs to modernize in order to adapt itself. Bringing in artificial intelligence and automation into the skill development sector can transform the education offered in this domain. The sector also requires high-end institutional reforms. For example, the Director General of Employment has been burdened with several other jobs. And it is high time that the Director General of Employment has moved from Ministry of Labour to Ministry of Skill Development and Entrepreneurship in order to maintain the quality of vocational training that is being offered by the ministry. Currently, the skill development sector gets most of its finance from multinational bodies like World Bank and also from corporate social responsibility under the Companies Act 2013. But this is clearly not sufficient in order to educate the huge number of youths of our country. So this finance requires complete reforms. For example, reimbursable industrial contribution can be employed for enhancing the finance. Under this reimbursable industry contribution scheme, the employers will contribute about 1-2% of the payroll tax to the government if they educate and provide vocational training to the youths and provide sufficient data accordingly to the government. This 1-2% tax will be reimbursed to them. This can be used as efficient method to provide finance to the skill development sector. The second article is with respect to Article 35A of Indian Constitution, and this Article 35A has been in news for pretty some time now, so this becomes an important issue for both prelims and the mains. The Supreme Court will examine if Article 35A affects the basic structure of Indian Constitution. Here one has to know what Article 35A is and also what basic structure of Indian Constitution is. First, let's see what 35A is. Article 35A is with respect to the people and the state of Jammu Kashmir. Let's see them in detail now. And the basic structure of Indian Constitution is a collective term which was coined in a case called as Kesavardhana Bharati case in the year 1973. The fundamental rights of our constitution provides right to equality, rights against non-discrimination, right to liberty, right to life and dignity to all the people in our country. And this basic structure of Kesavananda Bharati case protects the fundamental rights of the constitution, which makes that the government cannot amend the fundamental rights unilaterally if it goes against the rights of the people. If the amendments are done by the government unilaterally, then Supreme Court can step in and undo the amendments in order to safeguard the rights bestowed on the people of the country by our constitution. According to Article 35A of our Indian Constitution, Jammu Kashmir State Legislature can decide who are the permanent residents of their state. And the permanent residents of the state can get special rights and privileges in state public sector jobs, acquisition of property within the state, and also other benefits like scholarships for education and also public aid and welfare programs within the state. It also adds a clause that no act of the state legislature which is under the ambit of Article 35A can be challenged for violating the basic structure of Indian Constitution or any other law in Supreme Court. With respect to the state of Jammu Kashmir, one also needs to know about Article 370 of Indian Constitution. According to Article 370, a person can have dual citizenship if he resides in the state of Jammu Kashmir. One is the state citizenship and one is Indian citizenship. And the state of Jammu Kashmir also has its own flag. And all the fundamental rights enshrined in our constitution does not apply fully to the state of Jammu Kashmir. Jammu Kashmir also has its own constitution. An outsider is not eligible to buy its own property or land in the state of Jammu Kashmir. Recently, a writ petition was filed by an NGO called We the Citizens, challenging the validity of both Article 35A as well as Article 370 in our Supreme Court. It questioned the validity of both the articles based on the following arguments. It said that four representatives from Jammu Kashmir state were part of Constituent Assembly and they did not ask for any special provisions or special status to the state of Jammu Kashmir while framing the constitution. According to Article 370, it exclusively states that it is only a temporary provision and not a permanent one. And this Article 370 and 35A are against the very spirit of oneness of Indian constitution. And it creates a class within class of Indian citizens, which is against the principles enshrined in our constitution. And these two articles also violate the fundamental rights of Article 14, 19 and 21 of Indian constitution, which guarantees right to equality for all the citizens of our country. The next issue is the CJI raises Justice Joseph issue with Attorney General. The conflict between the government and the judiciary has been going on several years in our country, and this is one such point which can be added to the same tussle going on for ages. The government has taken a unilateral decision to alter the seniority of Justice K.M. Joseph against the wishes of Supreme Court of our country. This unilateral decision of the government against the wishes of the collegium is against the principle of separation of powers between various organs in our country, which is enshrined as a part of basic structure of Indian constitution. The next issue we are going to see today is with respect to segregation of waste. SC questions the inability to segregate waste. The Supreme Court has questioned the people of Delhi for their inability to segregate waste generated in their own home. Waste segregation is an increasing issue in our country. The segregating of waste as biodegradable and non-biodegradable is a very essential step, and it's a first step in order to utilize the waste and convert it into useful energy. The Supreme Court has not just questioned the rationale of slum dwellers, it also questioned the rationale of the educated people who are well aware of the consequences of non-separation of the waste into biodegradable and non-biodegradable. The article also provides empirical insights with respect to the National Capital Territory of Delhi. For example, in Delhi, there is almost 10,200 tons waste is produced per day, and out of which almost only half of the waste is disposed of in useful way of converting waste to energy. We have to know what waste to energy plant is. The waste to management plant is a waste management facility which uses the principle of combustion to transform the waste in order to produce useful energy. And these plants rely on mass burning of the municipal solid waste, which involves complete combustion of the waste to produce ash. Depending upon what type of material is combusted, the output varies. Usually, the gases generated contains dioxins, furans, which can also be toxic at times. So, in order to utilize this waste to electricity technology, segregation of waste into biodegradable and non-biodegradable is very much important to avoid the health consequences. This chart shows the renewable energy status in our country. As we can see, as it shows, the waste to energy conversion at installed level currently is only 106 megawatts. However, the potential stands at whooping 3,880 megawatts, which is to be utilized only when there is proper segregation at the household level. The next issue we are going to see today is with respect to the public sector banks. One third of public sector banks remain headless. This shows the leadership crisis existing in the public sector banks in our country. The MD and CEO post of major public sector banks like Andhra Bank, Allahabad Bank, Canara Bank, Central Bank of India, etc., they remain vacant for several months by now. The appointments to the head of public sector banks is done by an appointments committee which is headed by the Prime Minister of this country. It is also to be noted that recently government has brought in a new scheme called as Indradhanush in order to bring in banking reforms, one of which reforms also includes the solving the leadership crisis in the public sector banks. This problem of leadership crisis can become very big, especially in the festival season, wherein the credit demand will pick up multifold. Apart from the leadership crisis, the Indian banking sector has been suffering from various other issues for past few years. For example, the issue of non-performing assets is one of the biggest issues. The government has brought in several reforms like insolvency and bankruptcy code in order to solve the NPA issues. The government has also went in for bank recapitalization, wherein it infuses money via budget allotments in order to restore the health of the public sector banks. The Indian banking sector has also been facing the issue of governmental pressure. For example, implementation of the welfare schemes like Jan Dhan Yojana or implementation of the priority sector lending requirements has reduced the profitability of the Indian banking sector, which has also increased the crisis situation. The next issue we are going to see today is with respect to Center's plan to devise new methods in order to block some mobile apps. The central government has asked the telecom service providers in order to explore new methodologies to block applications such as Facebook and WhatsApp. The possible ways to block them must comply with the provisions of Information Technology Act 2000. This blockage of apps is very much essential in case of emergency situation. For example, the recent Jammu Kashmir emergency situation has led to complete internet blackout. In case of an emergency situation, instead of blocking the complete internet, if one devises a way to block the exclusively apps such as Facebook and WhatsApp, which spreads false news, it would be very easy for the government to preserve the national security. And this slide shows the provisions of Information Technology Act 2000. This act was implemented based on United Nations Commission on International Trade Law, and the electronic fund transfers is regulated under this law in our country. This act has been implemented to whole of India, including the state of Jammu Kashmir, in order to deal with the cyber crimes occurring in India. This act also regulates other features like electronic records and electronic digital signatures and documents with respect to them. The last topic we are going to see today is with respect to HIV/AIDS. Three northeastern states emerge as new HIV hotspots. The three new states are Meghalaya, Mizoram, Tripura. This is as per the data given by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. These three states have seen an increasing prevalence of HIV/AIDS because of increase in use of injecting drug users and unsafe sexual practices which has been followed in these states. For example, three places like Aizwal, Champhai and Kolasib has a prevalence of 37, 33 and 38% of injectable drug usages when compared to rest of the country where the prevalence is only 6.3%. On a whole, as per the data of 2015, the national adult HIV prevalence in the age group of 15 to 49 is about 0.26%, which is very low when compared to what we had in the 1950s. The ways in which HIV/AIDS is transmitted include heterosexual methods, which constitutes almost 87% of the AIDS prevalence in our country. Also, homosexual methods of AIDS transmission is also prevalent, which constitutes about 2%. Injecting drug users, parent-to-child transmission, blood and blood product transmission also constitute major reasons for transmission of AIDS in our country. A person suffering from AIDS all over the world, especially in India, is vulnerable to discrimination and social stigma. In order to stop the social stigma faced by these people, it is important to increase the awareness about the disease. Without proper awareness and behavioral changes, the marginalization will continue to persist in social, economic and legal spheres, which will push the people into the cycle of poverty and deprive them of their economic rights. Thank you.